as we look at this, it's just a slight introduction here. We're going to be talking about Jesus, the true vine. The Bible says, some of our notes anyway, the last verse in chapter 14 tells us that Jesus and the disciples are about to leave the upper room. They are headed to the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus will pray with his great high priestly prayer and will later be arrested by the mob led by Judas. Apparently, Jesus speaks the words which makes up chapters 15 and 16 en route to the garden. In this chapter, Jesus is pictured for us as the true vine.
Yes.
I can imagine Jesus and these men going through the darkened streets of the city and then passing beyond the walls into the surrounding. Passing around the walls into the surrounding countryside. During this time of year, or that time of year anyway, mid-April, the grapevines will be beginning to blossom with the promise of a fresh harvest. As Jesus walked with his disciples, perhaps he reached out and took a vine in his hands and used it to teach an object lesson to his men. His desire is to teach them about the most vital relationship they have in their lives. I want to say that again. His desire is to teach them about the most vital relationship they have in their lives, the one that is with Jesus and his Father. Now, there's more, and I want to take my time and love on you this morning because... Yeah, this afternoon, because it's so easy for us to kind of go through the motions and miss out on what really God is saying and doing. In my life right now, I am, as many of you know, I'm prepared to graduate in May, and I'm excited about all that good stuff. But here's the funny thing. I got all the way just about to the end where I've taken all the required courses, have gotten, thanks be to God, an A in absolutely everything that I've taken. And then... Oh, God, please let me get this out. This is hard. I get all the way to the end, and if there was one course, it was one that you're supposed to take the minute you start college. It was like some internet research. It was something. Yes, some of you know. I was going to say something I shouldn't say. But yeah, that internet research. And because, you know, I was like, this is a no-brainer, I ended up getting a B. In that course, this was some time ago, probably years ago. But this class I'm taking now, I have a marketing class, which is going very well. I expect to have an A, and I have an A average right now, so we'll be fine. One more week, we'll be done. But this one class that I'm taking, this art and photography class, and it is a beginner's course. And I thought to myself that it should be a breeze. Is a royal. And it seems like, Mother Tillman, that everything I submit to this professor, he wants more. It's not good enough.
Wow.
Now, I keep saying it's a beginner's course, which is why I took the course. And I want to say this. I want to say this because there's somebody who's going to be blessed by what I'm sharing. Because sometimes life is like this. I was listening to Dr. Chan this morning, and he was sharing how for those who know him, he's a very bright gentleman, but I found myself, we have a lot of ways that are very similar. And what I mean by that is he was sharing, and I said, God knows this is my testimony. Has anybody ever had the favor of God upon their life to the degree where you always end up in settings and with people where your credentials don't match theirs?
Amen.
Or better yet, because it's not just about credentials. Have you ever been in a place where people are talking and they're using big words?
Yes.
And you have a decision to make. Number one, you know you don't understand what they're talking about. But you, because of pride, you want to act like you know what they're talking about until they say, what do you think? To be real smooth with it, you know, the response that you typically will give will be, you know, I've pondered that for some time myself. When there's really nothing wrong with saying, I don't know what y'all talk about. He went so far to say that there was another theologian who was probably one of the most well-known and renowned theologians during this time. And he says, you know, this gentleman invited him to this conference. And he got the letter to go, and he called some of his other buddies, and they were like, who did you say invited you? And they told him who, and they was like, man, he invited y'all, he didn't write me, you know, going back and forth, whatnot. So he says, well, here's what he wants me to talk about. And it was something deep. And He says, his other buddy he's talking to, he says, would you do me a favor? He says, man, since you know so much about it, he said, why don't you write the paper for me? And I'll just talk about it. He said, man, gladly, I'll do it for you. So he writes the paper, he goes to the conference, and he's reading it verbatim and talking, you know, using all the words and whatnot. And it's a shame that he did that, because he figured out that, he said, no one ever told him that there was going to be a question and answer period. And so he's up there, you know, he had covered the notes and everything like his buddy had written the paper. And he says, you know, they started to ask questions one by one, and he said, and he couldn't answer. He said, most of the reason why he couldn't answer is he didn't understand himself. So my point is, there are times for which, let's not fake the funk. There are times which you're having difficulty with things.
Amen.
And it's okay to say, I don't know.
Amen.
Watch this. The anointing is not going to lift from your life because you don't understand the big word.
Right.
What's my point? Learn to be comfortable in who we are. Even in our church, and I watch this, there's certain people that everything they do has to be on a grand scale because you're so busy thinking about what people think about you.
Amen.
I remember sharing with a couple not too long ago, please stop. Don't ever get to the place where you feel like you gotta fake it until you make it. I don't believe you should do that.
Amen.
Why don't you just be okay and be satisfied with just being you? Because the real deal is this. If you don't seem to have enough love in your heart because I might not have enough money for you, then I don't think I got enough love for you.
Amen.
Amen. It's real talk. See, guys, listen. Friends, I want the people who roll with me when I didn't have $500,000 in the bank.
Amen.
Anybody can get new friends that spring up once you got something that they want. And let me flip the script real quick. It's not just about money. I know people who truly just want to be connected to me because of influence.
Yeah. Amen. Amen.
They don't have time for that.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
So getting all the way up to this course here, and I'm doing everything the professor says to do, and here's where he challenged me. He says, Mike, he says, you're extremely literal. He says, I need you to think outside of the box. And I'm saying to myself, it's an 8-week course. This is the 7th week. What are you talking about? And here's why I share what I shared about, you know, people, big words, and, you know, you can be in crowds with people and environments where you feel like you don't have the credentials, you don't know what they're talking about. Just about everybody else in the class, I can tell that this is not a beginner's course for them. And I can tell because when I look at the photography, I'm looking at the angles, they're much more advanced. Now, we all took the classes for the same reason, because it was a dumb elective. So we thought. Until he continues to challenge us and push us and challenge us and push us. Had me running all over town. Laying down on the street trying to get right angles and stuff. Just this nonsense. Embarrassing myself for the people of God on the bus taking pictures and getting on. First lady, honey, you're taking, you're doing your homework on the Sabbath. Shut up, I gotta get the shot. To make matters worse, I come here, and Brother Jonathan is extremely good. He's helped pastor, he's been a blessing to me. I didn't know that Elder Williamson, Sister Nikita, is also taking courses. And so there's certain terms that we started to throw out, and I can tell who knows about them and who doesn't. I say aperture, they just perked up. I know exactly, F-stops, I know exactly what you're talking about. ISO, white balance, all that kind of stuff. Stuff that I really wasn't in my heart to know.
Yes.
Yes. My professor says, Mike, he says, this is really nice, but I need more. So I told Pastor Veronica, thank God for her. I said, if I see him, and I remember his name, I'm not going to tell you, but I remember his name. If I hear his name at graduation, yeah, I'm going to punch him right in his chest so hard. And then she said, no, you're not, Pastor. No, you're not. God, here's where she brought the spirit. And she says, God is trying to stretch you.
Wow.
Well, God didn't tell me that. Why am I telling you all this? In the end, and thank God for those who are others that I've talked to have shared and said, Pastor, you know, this is a season where God, now catch this now, God is trying to get you to pay attention to some of more of the, you know, the more important details.
Wow.
See, while you might have the right shot, you know, if you really want people to focus on the right thing, you got to make sure that you have proper use of your negative space. You got to make sure it's a proper and appropriate amount of lighting. There's a whole lot of things that goes into the photography, if you will. But I didn't know then that I know now. And watch this, God is the same way. And here's how we did me. There are times in which I'm out walking and I start paying attention to nature. The same way that Jesus set the stage for his disciples here in John chapter 15, I'm sure in my heart that they're walking, whether it be at night or whether it be through the course of the day, but he sees a branch, he sees trees. He reaches for things that they can identify with. And now watch what he says, because you know, you might think this is some scripture written 1,500 years ago, over 2,000 years ago. Let me tell you something. It's relevant for today because many of us still are reaching for the wrong stuff. Watch this. He says here in verse 1, he says, I am the true vine. He just doesn't say I'm the vine. He says I'm the true vine. And he's got to make that statement because there are a lot of vines out here.
Amen. Amen.
Many of us are reaching and looking for things, and you're looking to pull strength from all the wrong places. And God is saying, I am the
true vine. Amen.
I could read this verse and sit down and be honest with you because I understand what he's saying here. Not only is he the true vine, he also says here, and my father is the husbandman. Do we really, really recognize what that means? I pray that we get to the place where we really, really can receive what that text is saying to us. Once again, I am the true vine. So that means beware, Michael, because if there's a true vine, then there's got to be a false vine.
Right.
And not to indict anybody, but watch this. What happens a lot of times is that you have to experience certain things in life before that connection is made. That watch this. And there's nothing deep, because like many of you probably can identify with your pastor. I laughed that I'm graduating with honors. I remember Dr. Chan, he was talking about this, bless him, he said he was in seminary school, and he had other buddies that were graduating, they had the little gold bars and all that kind of stuff. He's like, I want that. And he said, I was always smart enough to get it, but I was like, whatever, they're going to walk across stage just like I am. And I said, he's not just like me. And so he said he figured out the math, exactly what he needed to do to graduate with honors. And he got all the way there. He said his first sermon that he preached, he got an A on it. And he figured, well, if I got an A on this, I'm going to do my best, and I'm going to just do a little bit more, and I'll probably just keep getting A's. But of course, the professor caught on to it, and he gave him a C. And he shared with the professor verbatim. He says, you know, man, you know, you are keeping me from graduating with honors. And, you know, when our story goes on, guess what? The professor never changed his grade.
Wow.
And he said he missed being able to walk with honors by this much. Now, what's the multiple story concerning that? Always come with your A game.
Amen.
Always give it your absolute best. Knock the ball out the park. The way I learned to view it is he only got 8 weeks. Get it in and get it over with.
Amen.
I never thought it would impact my life the way that it's impacted my life. I was so cheap, I didn't even buy the camera. I said, I'm a bar from a friend of mine. But things are expensive, amen.
Yes, they are.
But after going through the process and the way that I have been just made, I think I'm going to buy me a camera after this.
All right, there you go.
Now watch this. Now here's what God started to do to me. So I was out walking, and I started paying attention to branches. I started paying attention to trees. I started paying attention to texture. And the list goes on and on and on with just the things you start to see once you are trained or taught what to look for.
Yeah.
Here, we are here in this congregation, right here, right now, and God has set us up. I mean, he has blessed us beyond measure.
Yes. Yes.
Amen.
Thank you.
Watch this. I don't think anybody in this congregation wants for anything.
Amen.
That's what I think. Now, I'm sure somebody's going to come up after service and tell me what you think you want or what you think you want, whatever. But here's the deal. For the most part, everybody here has what they need.
Yes.
And I can say that confidently because I know the word and not necessarily your personal business.
Thank
Amen.
You,
Amen.
I quote some scriptures to say, either you lying or God is. And I think
come on.
See, because there's certain blessings and certain things that God has for us, but it's going to require for us to make some changes.
Yeah.
Amen.
You say to yourself, I can't live without that, or I don't want to do that. That's no longer God's fault. It's yours because you were not willing to do what he was telling you to do in order for you to continue to walk in the promises or in the blessings of God. That's
Amen.
Deep right there. So let me get back to this. He says, I am the true vine. And then he says, and my father is the husbandman. Do y'all realize what a husbandman does? A husbandman takes care of the garden.
Amen.
It is the husbandman's job to provide for the garden.
Amen.
To make sure that you have the proper soil, to make sure that it's water.
Amen.
I mean, the whole process, it's the husbandman's responsibility. So having said that, everybody, is that simple enough?
Amen.
Why is it that you find yourself wanting to be the husband? At best, all you are is an extension of God.
Amen.
You're not God.
No.
You're an extension of God. Michael and McKay, I've been enjoying myself walking around with my daughter and going to these college tours and whatnot and just having a wonderful time. I'm enjoying myself going with my son. His team just won the championship, the basketball championship just yesterday. Just having a great time. It's some very powerful lessons. I was telling my wife this morning, some very teachable moments that I'm grabbing hold of with my children as they go through life. It's just wonderful. And the thing that I really love about my kids is they recognize that they don't really have to want for anything. They let us know. And we break our necks like the loving parents that we are to make sure that they have it. And don't look at me like I'm crazy. You do it for your kids, too.
Amen.
I mean, Michaela's 17. You know, she's got an appointment tonight. You know, we're just trying to figure out how we're going to drive there and do this. And I mean, I drive across town. Just crazy stuff. Well, she got her own car. She can drive her own stuff. But what's the problem? I'm trying to hold on to it as long as I can.
Amen.
Come on, I'm running out of time.
Amen.
That's right.
One of them might be like, why are they so spoiled? What is the difference between spoiled, rotten, and spoiled?
Right.
As long as they're spoiled, that's a good thing.
Amen.
It's the spoiled rotten that we got to have.
Right.
It is the difference, and by the way, Jesus is talking about this even in the text, because if you look at this prophet who ministers about this, he talks about the fact that Israel was bringing forth, there's a difference between good grapes and wild grapes.
Yes.
The wild stuff is sour.
Yes, right.
And it's bitter. The good stuff is kind of like the grapes Sister Shane picked sometimes. If you stay after service, you get a chance to start eating those good grapes. I mean, it's just nice and sweet. That's the good stuff. That's what really God wants for us.
Yeah.
Amen.
But what happens with the churches, now watch this now. He says, as long as you stay connected to me, that's your food source, that's your life source.
Yes.
What's happening with the church a lot of times, Marcus, is we allow God, we stay connected to God in certain areas of our life, Sister Diane, and then there's certain areas we detach, Elder.
Yes.
And we detach, Elder, because we really think we have it under control. But eventually we really don't have it under control. Many of us trust God probably with a vow, I want to say maybe 50% of our life, and then the other portion, Nikita, it's in our hands. And we know it's in our hands because there's certain statements that we make that let me know, Stanley, you know you haven't fully submitted or surrendered to the Lord. And why would you do that? I'm convinced, Elder Johnson, that we only do that because we really don't understand God's place in our lives.
Amen.
Think about what he says in the text. And like I said, this is probably the most simplest sermon I probably have ever preached here at New Bethel. I want to talk to you about, because I'm not finished reading just all the history, but this blesses me to know that Jesus is about to be crucified. He's about to be sacrificed for the world. And this, Jeff, is an intimate conversation that he's having. Watch this now, with his disciples. He says, I am the true vine and my Father is the husbandman. Can I tell you something, Mr. Tracy? It is God's will that you have no need at all.
Amen.
Can church, can you embrace
Amen.
That?
Yes, sir.
It is really his will that you have no need at all. And as I shared, this is so good. Let me move on. I wanted to talk about first thing, the personality of the true vine. The personality of the true vine. So those of you who are taking notes, write that down. The personality of the true vine. You see that in verses 1-3. The personality of the true vine. The personality of the true vine. Everybody got that? Before I start giving you the bullets, you know, you might ask yourself, why did Jesus give them this teaching now? He's getting ready to die. He's getting ready to leave them. You know why he gives it to them? Because they need it.
Amen.
New Bethel, we are living in a day and a time for which we need it. We need God's truth. We need
yes.
his word.
Yes.
Watch this. So when I say the personality of the true vine, the genuineness of the true vine, Jesus and Jesus alone possesses life within himself.
Yes, he does. Wow.
Jesus and Jesus alone possesses life within himself. You know, I was living, and I can remember life without Christ being in it. My life, that is what I'm trying to make. And I will tell you, I live a much better life today with him than I did without him.
Amen.
And let me be very, very clear when I say that. There's a level of peace and a level of joy that I have that I didn't have when I did not have Christ in my life. What I did not say, Brother Jeff, is that I never have any problems, and Sister Dana, that I never go through anything. That's not true. But I can tell you today, Sister Burton, I have peace like I've never had before in my life because I know Jesus Christ. Some people are struggling with that. And I'm talking about the genuineness of the true vine. Watch this. What he's really after is for you to have the joy. See, the difference between being happy is that something's got to happen first. That's external. Mm-mm. We're talking about the joy of the Lord, where no matter what happens, I still find peace in Christ because I believe that God has everything under control. And if it has happened to me, there is a purpose and a plan that God has for it. And finally, after living 40-some-odd years on this earth, now when things happen, I step back and I say, but God, what are you saying about me? Because he's trying to get something to us. He's trying to mature us. He's trying to develop us. And at the end of the day, please, when you get frustrated and when you don't understand things, stay connected to the vine.
Amen.
What do you mean, Pastor Smith? Don't make decisions like I'm not going to come to church.
Wow.
Amen.
Don't make decisions like I'm not going to get on the prayer line.
Amen.
Don't make decisions like, you know, I'm just going to stay away. I don't want to talk to anybody. I'm telling you, that's the trick of you-know-who. Stay connected.
Amen.
There's a reason why he says that he's the vine and we're the branch. Listen, has anybody ever seen a branch exist by itself?
No.
You know what's going to happen? I spent a lot of time in the park getting this revelation. I'm not learning disabled or anything like that, but I just took a lot of time in the park. Have you ever been walking? This is how God has done me in ministry, and I get why Jesus is the type of teacher that he is. I remember the very first time God did this to me, I used to drive, I was working in Philadelphia Electric Company, no, Baltimore Gas and Electric Company, and I would take the bus from up my way downtown, 39 was Lexington Street and all that kind of good stuff. And then one day, I was taking the bus coming back home, and I got off the bus and I forgot where I parked. I got up at the wrong stop. And the distance was, let's just say it was several miles.
Wow.
So, at First Lady was nowhere near me. So, God only knows how long it took for me to call her to tell her, please come get me and all kinds of stuff. So, I said, you know what, I'm going to walk. And I walked. And while I'm walking, you know, my feet's bobbing because I don't have the right shoes and stuff like that. But I'm enjoying the scenery. And get this, what God started to show me at that point was, I saw houses that have been there all along that I had never seen before because I'm so busy. Zoom.
Oh, yeah.
I saw trees. I saw plants. I mean, it was just amazing. I saw so much that I never saw before, but I've been living in that area for years. And why? Because I never took the time to slow down and just appreciate my surroundings, or for us, slow down and just enjoy life. Like today, like right now, I guarantee you there's some people in their minds, they already have checked out. You already know what you're gonna do when church is over and all that kind of good stuff. But you listen, you're robbing yourself of the beauty of true worship and being able to connect with God. There's something God wants you to get. I'm telling you, at the end of the day, he really wants us to slow down.
Amen.
The reason why sometimes you can't identify with that peace is because you don't take the time enough to figure out you got peace. You just move to the next thing. Soon something gets, I got to do this. I got to. No, you don't have to. And trust me, I'm authorized to preach this type of sermon because I don't stay still.
Amen.
One of my buddies, you know, I was out late just Thursday night. The Red Cross is just relentless. They just keep calling me. You want to get blood? I have O positive blood, so that's the one that's supposed to everybody needs or could use. And they just blow me up. So finally, the day that I say I'm going to give them blood, my appointment's at 6:30. I don't leave that place till about 8. They sucked every bit of life out of me. Something's going on, which is late. But the reality of it is, yeah, I'm always trying to do something and give to somebody. And why am I like that? Because guess what? Today, I can give, but tomorrow I might need to receive.
That's right.
So God shows me, you know, don't be so busy where you can't be a blessing.
Amen.
Don't be so busy where you can't get back. So we said, watch this, the personality of the true vine. One is that there's the genuineness of the true vine. We know that's our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Watch this. All other vines are counterfeit.
Amen.
He alone is the true source of everlasting abundant life. Have you ever connected with somebody and you knew they were toxic?
Yeah.
Okay, I heard Minister Tracer, her Elder Jason, says Nikita, says Jessica, nod their head like they know what I'm talking about. Okay, now I'm going to say this again. Have you ever connected with somebody and you knew they were toxic?
Yeah.
But you just enjoyed them.
Yes. Amen.
Come on, church, y'all. You know I know what I'm talking about.
That's right.
You just enjoy them. And you know what? Watch this. You enjoy them to the degree where you'd rather go through whatever it is you're going to have to go through in order to keep them in your life because you just like how they make you feel.
Yes.
Or you just like hanging with them. And I'm here to tell you, after a while, it gets old.
Oh, yeah.
Amen.
Because there's a price to pay for being disobedient to God.
Yes.
Amen.
And come on, doesn't bad company corrupt?
Yes.
I know most of us, you like Pastor. I got challenged by a friend of mine this week. He said, Mike, I don't understand why you like hanging with this person and that person. I said, because I feel like I can handle it. I know they got some ways, you know, I'm not Jesus, but I'm his son.
Come on.
So I figured I could convince or persuade them. And it was a sad thing. I had to make an honest decision and say, you know what? They're not trying to come to church.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I had the scriptures to support everything. Paul was like, you know, to the people who are under the law, I become all things to all men. You know, that doesn't mean you got to become a sinner.
Not at all.
Thank God for the four amens I got. Jesus, Lord God. Let me move on here. So the gardener of the true vine. The word husband refers to the vine dresser, the gardener, the one who has the responsibility of caring for the vineyard. Jesus says that the Heavenly Father is the gardener. Do you all really believe that God cares for you?
Yeah.
How many of you here have lived to experience God, I mean, really be fighting on your behalf, blessing you, working for you? So why is it that we act like he's not going to do it? I see, and I'm so glad Brother Stanley's here and his girlfriend. I'm so glad to see them here. Because I was praying about him and her too, and I was saying, God, don't let them forget. This is not that this is the case. I'm just sharing this with you. Not too long ago, Brother Stanley wasn't feeling the best, and we were praying for him, went to see him at the hospital and whatnot, and then I thought, you know, because I didn't see him for a while, I said, God, don't let him forget what you did for me.
Amen.
And I think him coming and bringing his girlfriend with him as they come, it's his way of saying, God, thank you.
Amen.
your girlfriend's name again? Brianna. Yeah, I was going to say Brianna. All right. And watch this. While we're clapping for them, they're young people. We got older saints in here who act like they don't know, like God ain't do nothing for them.
Yeah.
I mean, and you and I both know God provided for you.
Amen.
You and I both know God continues to
Amen.
Make a, listen, have anybody really, and, you, and I like to say it like this because it's safe. Has anybody ever, I mean, literally had your back up against the wall and God keeps bailing your behind out?
Yes.
And I'm not going to call you a liar because you really do believe that if he gets you out of this, you're not going to do it no more.
Right.
And you go back and get right into it. I mean, come on, can we just talk about the grace of God? He doesn't expose you.
Come on.
And even if he does tell somebody your business, he doesn't release them to tell you that he told them. We talked about the genuineness of the true vine, the gardener of the true vine. And I don't know about you all. I'm excited. This is increasing my faith, Dana, because, you know, I watch you with Elder Johnson, and just about every Sabbath that you guys can make it, God understands that that's a tremendous sacrifice.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
He understands that. And God is not going to allow you to do more for him or what he does for you. You know, it may be challenging now, but it's not going to always be challenging. There's truly something that God is birthing in the two of you through that divine sacrifice. And so here's the thing, you know, just like there are very few people that are around and doing things for you, like while you're pressing your way, you know, just get ready for it because God is teaching you some things. Because I tell you what, you know, the harvest is going to be great.
Amen.
Because you guys have spent years of putting stuff into the ground. Amen.
Amen.
So watch God perform, I mean, in a mighty manner for you all. You know, you all have stood the ridicule of people saying, why do you travel 3 hours one way to get to church? There's a church right around the corner. Or there's church in a short amount of distance. Here's the important thing. You got to know where God told you to go.
Amen.
It's going to be them. Never mind. Keep going. Praise God. Just get ready for it. Get ready for it. God's not going to fail you. Amen. You know why? Because he's the husbandman. He sent you here, and he's going to provide for you, too.
Thank you, God.
Nah, I think we missed that. He sent you here, and he's going to provide for you, too.
Amen.
Hey, listen to Pastor, please. There should be no stress and no worry in our lives.
Amen.
If you truly believe Kiani, I just want to close my notes up, Jeff, and just share from my heart. Because, Crystal, here's the challenge. You know, when God looks at us, he says, okay, is everybody familiar with Psalm 23?
Amen.
Thank you, Elder. Is everybody fairly familiar with Psalm 23? The Lord is my
shepherd.
Okay, you know what we do? If he's the shepherd, what's our job? Just to be the one. That's it. I'm not looking for nothing deep. If he's the shepherd, then... You know what we do a lot of times? We want to be the shepherd.
Amen.
All right, so here's the deal. Like, so you have the tree trunk, right? And we see that the tree is supposed to go all the way down to the ground. We see roots that are there, right? And then what comes out of the trunk? Branches, right? And so guess what? What we do a lot of times is, now watch this. It is God's will that we bring forth fruit. I'm getting ahead of myself. It is God's will, Crystal, that we bring forth fruit. And you know what we do a lot of times as a branch? Sister Geneva, all we're supposed to do is stay connected to him. That's all he asks us to do. You know what we do? I want to bear fruit. Slow down. All he asks you to do, Nikita, is stand there in position and be a branch. And you know what we do? I want to bear fruit. All I need you to do is stay in position. And at the right time, you're going to bring forth fruit. That's his plan. But all he asks you to do is to be a branch and just hang there. Why can't we hang there? And we're not just hanging there, by the way. Why can't we hang there with our arms stretched out, just like a branch? You know why? Our focus is off. We don't understand our position in Christ. And therefore, we keep making a mess, and we keep trying to help him, trying to figure out why are we going through some of the same things we keep going through. You know why? Because we're out of position, or out of focus, if you will. He tells us here, he says, watch this. One of the things that a gardener does is he provides protection.
Yes.
Do you recognize that there's nothing that can happen to me or you without God's permission?
That's right.
Come on.
Now, this other part, I want to take some time to share with you. This is not the devil. I want to make sure I take some time, make sure you understand this. This is not the devil. You know what else he does that we don't have an appreciation for is God purifies us.
Amen.
You know what he does? As I was studying the text and looking at certain things, there's certain websites preachers can go to, lay people can go to as well, so it's nothing deep. What will help you understand, either if you're dealing with Hebrew, what he's talking about, it helps you understand Greek, what he's talking about, right? Good stuff, right? But I want you to understand this. purifying usually is a painful process.
Yes, amen. Yes.
Like, even if we just read the text here and we talked about, as soon as you mention the word pruning, that even sounds painful.
Yes.
Because it implies that something has to be cut back, sometimes cut off, or cut away. And nobody wants to be cut back, cut off, or cut away, but it's necessary for growth.
Yes.
I have lived, and some of you have lived long enough to know that, watch this, because God wants the disciples and he wants you to understand that the most important relationship, Brother Antoine, you ever have in this life is the relationship between you and your Heavenly Father, Jesus the Christ.
Amen.
Watch what he will do, Marcus. This is something that he will do because he did it there in the text. If you have people in your life that are for whatever reason preventing you from seeing what God desires for you to see, God is going to cut them off.
Amen.
And it's not that he doesn't want you to have friends. He wants you to have friends, but watch this now. Those friends should never take the place that God has in your life. And if you're so cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs over them and not him, he's going to remove them. Here's how you can tell it's God. Y'all have a falling out over a piece of chicken. You've been friends for 40 years. But it'd be something dumb, something small like that that you just can't seem to make up and get over. Here's another test. After you fall out, you pray about it. God, you know, this is really dumb, that's really small. You know, almost like that police officer that fired his weapon in the air because of them kids. But watch this, when I thought about it, I said, because they walked across his lawn. And I was like, grass grows back.
Right.
What happened is in the heat of the moment, stuff start happening, and you stop thinking clearly, and before you know it, something happened that you really regret. But you know how society is. Anybody giving you no free passes?
Nope. Nope.
Don't y'all thank God that he gives you free passes?
Yeah.
What's happening in our lives? God is purifying us. He's allowed us to go through some very difficult stuff. But it's purification. It's not a bad thing. That's what a gardener does. And you know what he does that I really don't like? Watch this. Ministries, can I use you as an example? We'll call them. So you know how you come just about every Sabbath, and you come every Sabbath, because she's going to be like, Pastor, you say just about, come every Sabbath. Watch this. You know how you love sitting there? So I'm going to switch up real quick. Sit up there. Go and get your Bibles and look and all that kind of stuff, and I'm going to just sit up there. Go ahead. Now see the look she just gave me? Keep going. Go ahead, keep going. I want you to get your stuff, get your pocketbook, get everything. I want you to act like you're not coming back to that seat. Hey, this is good. All right, this is good. Yep, go on and sit up there. Yep, get comfortable. Yep. Yep. How does it feel? Okay. She said different. You know why it feels different? There's a shift from here.
Yes.
Amen.
See, when you're down there, yeah, you magnify to a certain degree, but not that much. Up here, oh, you got to live right because all eyes are on you.
All eyes are on
you. Well, you shouldn't. If you don't live right, we're going to know it. Watch that. Without notice, God does stuff just like that. So what he does as a husbandman, in the vine, he will see that vine is sitting in a place where it shouldn't be sitting, and he'll take it, he'll pick it up, and sometimes he'll pin it to the wall. Sometimes he'll wrap it around whatever that piece of wood is that they have that's in the vine to help guide it in the direction that it should go. And you know what happens? We get irritated. We won't be bothered. It'd be the equivalent of me asking Sister Burden, you know, back there, she's had her eyes closed, she was just meditating. But if you're asking her to come on up here, listen, watch this now, I'm making a point. Asking her to come on up here and get on the drums. Most of y'all start laughing because you've never seen her play the drums. It might surprise you to know that she was a classical art or phenomenal drummer. It might surprise you to know that. But you never know if we never put her in a position. But the things that God does, he looks at you and while you're comfortable back there, he says, come on up here, I got a job for you. Sister April, lovely usher, but you know, God says, I haven't ordained you to usher anymore. Your season's over. I now want you to play the keyboard.
Yeah.
Amen.
Lord, I have never played a piano a day in my life. He didn't ask you that.
Amen.
What's happening in our purifying process? See, I become concerned about believers who are real comfortable in their position.
Wow.
You just come in and just slide and it's just everything good and fine. God didn't call you to comfortability.
Amen.
Right.
You watch this. You know why church a lot of times stays where we are? Because we're comfortable and we're not challenged to grow.
Amen.
Watch this. Matter of fact, thank you, Holy Spirit. He released me from this. I got four, no, it's almost six, 7 pages worth of notes. I'm just going to go from my heart because I feel this thing. You know what we really got to get back to, Shane? The number one thing that God wants, evangelists, he wants fruit.
Yes.
The reason why I just repositioned by example, Minister Tracy, and come here, look, Andrew, praise God, just as an example. Go up there and sit next to her. Who do we know that it wouldn't be God's will for her to pastor, for her to be assistant pastor? We don't know. But what happens in a lot of our lives is we look at people like, well, Lord, I know if God picked them, Lord Jesus, why would he do that? And you know what's funny? Like, I remember when I got called to pastor. You know, everyone had something to say. He's too young. I mean, I got all types. He's too young. He's too dark. He's too short. None of it mattered. Because with me being all of what they said, how about I be the man today? I didn't say, Lord Jesus, this is good stuff. But watch this now. Here's where I really, really want to go with this. And there's a lot more, but forget about it. I want to get to the meat of this thing. Why is it that you can come to church? Watch this. He says, because when you come, he says, it's God's will that you bring forth fruit.
Amen.
Why are we not bringing fruit? Why are we not bearing fruit? Why is it okay for us, Mike, to keep coming to church and we never tell anybody about Jesus? You know what happens? We're very comfortable, Jessica. And there's no pressure here. You got people that are dying in other countries, minister. But us, we can come in, just have church, have a good time, we hug each other. Hey, keep the slap file, and we go right back out the door. Life is usual. No, God doesn't want life as usual. He wants you to be stretched.
Amen.
You know why God allows us to go through many things, Geneva, to get our attention. Sometimes we'll say things like, you know, Lord, increase our faith. But then when he allows you to go through stuff, you act like it's the end of the world. I have never met anybody, Eddie, that is going to be mightily used by God that didn't go through anything today.
Amen.
It doesn't work like that.
Amen.
And he doesn't even care about the age. He will deal with people young. He will deal with people old.
Yes.
He's looking for available people.
Yes.
Get used to it during this season, because Jesus is about to move off the scene. You know what he does out there? He tells his boys, he says, listen, I'm sharing this message with you because you guys are going to need to hear it.
Yes.
And you know why? Because watch this. They didn't have to pray really hard because he was with them. They really have to fast through tough because he's with them and he was doing everything. But he knew if I don't talk to them from John 15, he says, guess what? These boys are going to be all over the place when I die.
Yeah. Wow.
He says, first of all, I'm the true vine. I don't care how good it get. And pastor's just talking about his own self. There are times in which I would get up in the morning and reach for the wrong stuff. And God was like, why are you doing that? I just love how the Holy Spirit deals with me. He never beats me up. He would just say stuff like, I wish you would spend that time with me. Happy yesterday when I got here. I was off work. I just got up and came down to the church. I was so excited. I sat back in my seat and said, God, it is good to be here in my office. And the Holy Spirit says, it's good to have you here.
Wow.
What do you think it would do for the Lord? Because he is after souls. Just imagine church. And this is just not about church growth. This is truly about us doing, Marcus, what God would desire for us to do. We say we really love the Lord. He has made such a difference in our lives. When I started out talking about this, there are many of you were saying, man, Pastor, you are so right. My life with the Lord has been far better than my life without the Lord. If that's truly the case, how come you don't tell people about it? When you know that if their hearts are not right with the Lord, they're going to hell. You know, it's so funny how people today want to debate. Well, is it really hell? Well, maybe it's this. Well, guess what? It is. And it's not okay that you knew that person's life was going to be taken and they were going to go to hell and you didn't say anything. I'm trying to tell you, that's not okay.
Amen.
So get prepared for God constantly dealing with you about us winning souls for Christ. Because you know what? Gone are the days we've done with us coming and just being comfortable here. You know what else, too, really, really, really has been on my heart that we got to do? I was glad to hear about the health fair. But you know what? It ought to be like just about every week we're really looking to give back to somebody who is in a lesser position than we are.
Amen.
Amen.
You know, it's the church's responsibility to help people who are poor, who lack.
Yes. Yes.
I know. You want to say that's their problem and not my problem. But you know, here's the deal. You're only just one paycheck away from being with them. And if God should see fit to let you go through something, don't you want somebody to have some compassion and some love and some understanding for you? Well, here's the deal. It would be good for you to get it while you got it good, as opposed to you that getting in your spirit or your heart when you don't have a job.
Amen.
Amen.
Boy, this is powerful. It says here, I am the true vine. My Father is the husbandman. So having said that, Markel, there's nothing that you should be wanting for. God already has it. Here's the thing. What he wants us to do is slow down and just start to rob to appreciate him. You know, God, I thank you for everything that I have. I thank God for getting certain things out of my system, because it just seems like it was so hard. You know, because we're so busy comparing ourselves to this person and to that person. Can I just continue to minister? I don't, like I said, this is a simple sermon, and I've had to throw the points out the window because I felt led by God to do this. But here's another thing that troubles God, and I know it troubles me too. Can we stop measuring our life or our success with the Lord based upon what we see on Facebook?
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah. I'm just going to share. Here's the deal. We will look at people on Facebook. If somebody takes a picture of their church and their church appears to be full, and you have five faithful members, you think they're more successful than you are. And that's really not the case. See, you don't know. They could have paid them people to sit in that picture. You don't know. Then you got people here because all your friends could put out there, hey, I just got engaged. You, that man probably beat their brains out every 2 weeks.
That's right.
But I want to be engaged. Anybody be? No, you know what? I'd rather stay single and happy and safe than be in an abusive relationship that wasn't God ordained. I'm just telling you the truth. But what we do is we look at what everybody else has, and we can't see the blessing that we have right now. I think there's a message in that.
Yeah.
Because while we're in their face, Facebook, why don't we get in God's face?
Right.
Lord, what do you have to say about me, God? You know, I mean, really. Everybody else seems to be graduating. I think I'm going to go graduate. Did God call you to do that? I'm just being honest with you. People who run off say, I'm going to school. Well, he might not have ordained, you know, college for you. I don't know. But you need to find out.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
Because you can find yourself, hello. You can find yourself running off down the path, and God said, I didn't tell you to do that.
Yes, sir.
And then you don't, and like that type of revelation don't even come until you've been doing it for like 5 years, you know, wasted money.
Right.
How about we save ourselves some time up front and go and pray and ask God, Lord, what do you want for my life? That is, here's the deal, it's just that simple.
Yes, it is.
With the church, a lot of times, we have made receiving the Holy Spirit this, it's, like this huge act of God, and it really isn't. Watch this. We just pray for Elder Harris. He's sitting right here. He's looking like he's fine. I don't know if he's in pain or he not. But I do know one thing. He stepped out for a little bit. I got word of some things going on, but I do know this much. He's sitting back in here. I do know this much, Brother Stanley wasn't, you know, doing the best a few weeks ago, but I do know he's looking fine. Speech is back. He's rocking and rolling.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's my point? Those two, I believe, got healed, and God continues to work with them based upon faith. Then nobody have to come to the hospital and start shouting and say, you put me in B flat and start rearing back. Nope, we just prayed. And watch this now. I just want you to see something. Salvation is received by way of faith. Healing is received by way of faith. Deliverance is received by way of faith. Watch this. The Holy Spirit is received by way of faith. If I never do a cartwheel, as long as I know I am saved, I believe God filled me with His Holy Spirit. It's received by faith. We want to put so many different type of stipulations on it, and I'm telling you, that's why the church is stagnant, and we're not seeing people come through with a baptism of the Holy Spirit because you feel like, wait a minute, I got to hear him speak. Sit down somewhere, because I'm not sure what you're speaking is a heavenly language. Everything that we stand to get from God, we will get it by faith. And I'm living right here, right now, according to John 15, where I realized that, guess what? He is the true vine. I have had other things in my life, probably like you, that, Nikita, it wasn't a true vine. It was a vine now. It gave you life for a little bit.
Yes.
But have you figured out that certain people will have you in their life as long as they get something from you?
Yes, sir.
And then when you can't give them what it is that they want, they forget your name. We was buddies. I mean, me and Minister Johnny were talking about this. It's like you work with people for years, and then, you know, you would, for whatever reason, move on, and you just reach back to be like, hey, remember I don't know you. I got you, doc. I'm going to send a referral. And it never comes.
Never.
What in the world? No, I didn't do you like that when you were going through something. I'm just trying to tell you, don't put your hope in the wrong things. Keep your hope and your faith and your trust and your confidence in God. Because the life that, watch this, that he has for us as believers, it's a life where, guess what? He's the shepherd. It's there's something wrong with him saying, come on, I'm going to lead you to green pastures. Come on, I'm going to lead you to a place where you can drink. But yet we always, what are we going to eat? What are we going to drink? Oh my God, I got to get over here. I ain't got to do nothing but live.
Amen.
You know what, two ladies and gentlemen, it's 129. You know what else I figured out when I was walking to Keaton? I was watching all different types of trees, just taking pictures of it and whatnot. And I realized something. Them branches don't work at all. They just... And I know people started to think I was crazy because at certain points while I was walking, I would just stop and look at the tree. It just stands there and brings glory to God.
Yes, it does. Amen.
The branch, I mean, I took one photo. It blessed me. It looked like the entire tree was barren, but then there was these little pieces that looked like fruit that was just hanging in place. And I had to take a picture of it because it's weird. And there's other blessing behind this that God was showing me. In the dead of winter, he can still cause things to blossom.
Hallelujah.
Sometimes the trees get confused because of the temperature, but they still blossom. And what it's bringing forth is absolutely beautiful. That's a different sermon. How many of you really, really believe God provides for you? I mean, you know he has. I mean, he truly has. He may not have always given you what you think you need, but he definitely gives you what it is that you do need. Trust me. You might be like, well, Lord, I think I need. He knows exactly what you need. He knows exactly where you are. And I'm telling you, you're where God wants you to be. Do me a favor. Just make sure you let him be God. Make sure you let him be God. It's 1:30. I'm not going to preach the rest of this. John 15 is really, really good. Yep, musicians, you can get in position. I just needed to just share this with the church. God wants us in position. What he said too that blessed me, he said, look at verse 2. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. When you read the word of God, I told you your pastor happens to be very literal. I just believe what God said. Evangelist Williams, if we don't start winning souls for Christ, we're going to disappear.
Amen.
Marcus, if you don't start sharing Christ with people at work and in the supermarket, Shane, if we don't get busy, I mean, you in the supermarket, that harvest is plenteous. And Jesus has the same problem we have. Elder, he said the laborers are few. Church is an interesting place because people like to come here and collect a check without doing nothing.
Amen.
We're going to reap all the benefits that God has for you. We don't want to give him nothing, Elder. What does it take for you just to drive? I mean, for those of us that are scared, just roll your window down. You can do it right today. After church, roll your window down, roll both of them down, and just keep shouting out, Jesus loves you, and hit the gas. You don't even have to interact with the person. Eventually, it ought to get to a point where, you know, you say, you know what? I'm not going to be ashamed of God because he's not ashamed of me. You don't have to be some deep theologian because at the end of the day, let me tell you something. I preach the gospel because I know what the Lord did for me. He changed my life. And I have an idea of kind of where I would be if I had not given my life to the Lord, if you allow me to say it like that. That's all he's looking for. And people will start to say, did he really make that difference? And you're like, yes, I'm a changed man because I gave my life to the Lord. Not religion. I'm a changed man because I gave my life to the Lord. One of the things that the church really appreciated last week and when I was preaching it, I shared with them. And this is how I know God does not want us being religious. When that prophet in the Old Testament, the book of Kings, was hungry, God sent an unclean bird to bring him his food. I'm convinced that there are people in this church who would say, I can't eat that. It's got the saliva of a raven on it. Let me tell you something. If that raven had brought me some fish, guess who was going to eat some salmon patties?
Amen.
With that unkosher, unclean saliva in it?
Yep. Yep. Yep.
1, 2, 3. Mm-hmm. Mm. Listen. Listen. Is God your life? I didn't say, should he be? I already know the answer to that. I'm asking you a question. Is God your life? Because you know what he says in the next verse? He says, abide in me and I in you. And watch this. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself. But why do we keep trying? We keep saying, I got this. And the reality of it is you don't have it. Because if you did have it, you wouldn't keep coming back with the same stuff. You don't. Stop. Admit it. Lord, I don't know what I'm doing. God, I'm about to make a mess. God, would you please help me? That's what I had to do with my studies. I was like, God, this man is starting to frustrate me to no end. It's not this serious. But you know what? Now, calm down. I said, God, what are you trying to show me? I forgot just that quick. I'm your man. He can't do nothing to me. Lord, what are you saying?
I went out there and, y'all, I was all over the place taking photography like I've been doing it for years. But it didn't come. Breakthrough didn't come until I prayed. Breakthrough didn't come until I positioned myself properly. Watch this. Submit to God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you, right? I'm not saying the professor was the devil, praise the Lord, but I'm just saying that sometimes what we want to do is do whatever we want to do and keep saying, well, God, what's happening? You haven't followed all of the steps. Amen. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I am the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. Everybody got that?
Amen.
Now, let's jump down to verse 7. Last verse I'm reading today. If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask.
Amen.
Here's the test for everybody. If God is not giving you what you will, you might want to check whether or not you're abiding in him. Now, I know sometimes I don't get stuff that I want to get because I'm not fully abiding. Pastor said that, because it's true. Like, do you get up every single time the Holy Spirit is leading you to pray?
No.
All right, stop lying, because some of you. No, you don't. Do you do absolutely everything God is telling you to do? How many of you are striving to get there? Look at what he said. And when he's saying abide, he's talking about dwell in him. Or to watch this now, remain in him. He says in verse 7, if ye abide in me and my words abide in you. That's the other thing. Sometimes we have a tendency, Elder Embry, to abide in him, but his word doesn't remain in us.
Wow.
And here's what I mean by that, Sister Nooney. You can come to church, you can go through all the motions. You can be here Friday, you can be here Sabbath day or Saturday, you can be here on Wednesday. But if ain't none of this getting inside of you, and I know a lot of people like that. They beat everybody else to church. I'm on my way to church. The Bible under their hand. Their Bible's just as new. It's so brand new and crisp, it could cut you. And then I could tell that it's not in them, because what happens as soon as they open their mouth and I ask them a question about anything, just life, so much negativity comes out. He says, but if ye abide in me and my words abide in you, he says, ye shall ask what ye... Wow. Man, sometimes what he's asking us to do, Minister Johnny, it's a little tough. It really is a little tough. God may say, I want you to go without TV. For somebody, this is rough. I need you to go without TV for 21 days. Really, God? Goodness, be some other way? Come on, just listen. And don't tell me that I don't know what I'm talking about, because Jesus did the same thing in Luke 22. He was like, God, seriously, would you please let this cup pass? No, I'm not passing a cup. You're the last person. Drink it. Or this cup is yours. Drink it. Some of us, it would really frustrate you to know in the spirit realm that certain things have not come to you in this life just yet because you haven't fully abided in him. We're on a part-time basis. Let me tell you something. God wants you. He wants all of you or none of you. Then he say he wants you hot. You're either going to be hot or cold, lukewarm, he'll spew you out.
Amen.
So how many want to be married to the husband man?